So here we are in our little fermenting room. We're coming for a wee warm up. It's very cold today. I think we're going to have bad snow tomorrow.
Yes, we're not looking forward to it. But we can keep warm with alcohol.
I'll probably get snowed in the borders tomorrow. So.
Oh no, snowed into a cider production facility. Oh,
it's dreadful, it's terrible. And that's why the bottle stocks are so low, because we had about 5 foot of snow a couple of weeks ago.
Yeah. He's only got like, I don't know, how many thousand bottles of cider have you got, and that's low?
Well, okay. This is a quiet time for us. In about 2 weeks' time, everybody just goes mental. It's March, the birds are starting to sing,
of course.
And people just go,
cider for
bring
cider
on the summer,
yeah.
I want my cider.
Definitely.
Everyone goes mad for cider.
So here we are, we're in the fermentation area,
yes.
And we've got some of the biggest airlocks I have ever seen. Bubblers, anyway.
Yes.
Obviously on a brewery fermenter, you have an industrial thing with a big pipe that went down and a little glass thing where you can see the bubbles, but as far as big homebrew kit is concerned, that's massive. Look.
We're very proud of the size of our bubblers.
They're large and bulbous.
And when this place warms up and things get going, then it will start to sing. Everything starts to, CO2 is produced, and but at the moment it's safe for us to be here. Because maybe a lot of your viewers, they'll know about CO2 production and homebrew
mm-hmm.
and fermenting.
Yeah.
But, you know, the industry still lose 2 or 3 people a year to CO2 poisoning.
So bloody hell.
And on
Lee
that note,
sorry everyone, Lee farted. Apologies for that.
So, you know, it's something that you have to be aware. In the old pubs, in the old brew house pubs, they used to have CO2 cellars where all, you know, they might be fermenting beer on site and the CO2 would end up at the bottom of the pub. And it's classic. Go in to sort of change a barrel or whatever. You're in the basement, CO2's heavier than air. You walk in there, boom, you're dead. So yeah, we do have to be careful.
Yeah. So what temperature do you generally like to ferment at? Is it about 20 Celsius or lower or higher?
Why do you say 20 Celsius?
Well, for home brewers, I know that most beer breweries would be around about 20 Celsius, or maybe even slightly lower than that on a commercial
mm-hmm.
scale.
Mm-hmm.
For a home brewer, I'm looking to ferment at about 20, maybe 22. I know that beer kits, you know, the tins of hopped malt extract that you get from Coopers, etc., they say between 21 and as high as 27. But everyone's got their different temperatures of what they prefer, and we'll give different flavours and stuff.
Yeah, I think the commercial boys would probably knock out. That's the cider siren. There's a cider emergency somewhere in the cider shed.
Quick to the cider cave!
and they'd knock out a batch at, I don't know what, 27 degrees, and just get through as quickly as possible.
Right.
We like to take our time. So it does depend on the time of year. This time of year, ideally, it's a great time to ferment because actually you're adding a little bit of heat to the process. So when we start off, it might be up about 18 just to get the fermentation started, and then after that, it can just tick away at 13.
Really? As low as 13? Right.
Why not? The Jaggy Thistle that we do, which is our sort of scrumpy, an East Lothian scrumpy, we just bung it outside, just let it do away. It'll come and go, that's it, that'll do.
Huh, well.
So,
we just stop farting, mate, honestly.
and then this secondary fermentation that we're talking about, the malolactic fermentation, once the cider's sort of fermented to dryness, about May, will start to warm up and the conditions will be right for that secondary fermentation. A lot of cider makers look for that, and they might do things to bring it on and speed up that process, because it really does help mouthfeel.
Yeah.
you lose some of that sort of more pronounced flavours, but you know, it's a good thing ultimately for us. We look for that. So particularly in the Jaggy Thistle, because the apples that we're using are quite sharp, you know. So and anything to counteract that.
Mm-hmm.
We don't want the scrumpy to be too complicated. That's not what it's about. So.
What kind of yeasts are you using?
Well, in the Jaggy Thistle, it's just wild yeasts, because it's a real cider.
Mm-hmm. Kind of, I think beer brewers would call that lambic beer.
Yeah, that's right. But with the cider that the majority of our cider that we make is made using a combination of three yeasts. Basically, one to get the fermentation started, one to finish off the job, and one for flavour characteristics. Saying that, we do just add a little bit. We don't want we don't want that to intrude into what's going on.
Yeah,
we're looking into control the cider production, but we don't want it to impose too much. So
it's a bit more complicated than we would necessarily do, for a homebrew perspective, as far as using multiple yeasts is concerned, because I wouldn't only use one yeast to make a cider.
Why would you use a yeast? Just leave it be. But from our point of view, we've sort of identified a profile for Thistlecross and our ciders, and we need to stick to that. So yes, there's variation from batch to batch, but on the whole, we create happy, healthy cider. So the fact the cider's is warm, it's got a lot of nutrition, a lot of feeding, and because yes, we're a craft producer, we want to be a mix of the best of commercial, what the commercial world has to offer. I don't want cider going buying in a bottle, and we don't mind slithering about with a whole load of strawberries, and doing hand pressed stuff. So. And that's what it's all about, really.
I've never thought of making a cider and just letting wild yeasts take care of fermentation then.
Uh-huh.
I might give that a shot, actually.
Depends on what your fruit's like, where it's come from, what state it's in. If you're buying it from the local supermarket, you might actually press it, mill it, turn it into pulp and let it sit for a day or so outside and pick up some of your own. Indigenous yeast is floating about, depending on the time of year. If you were using short bought juice or something like that, then yes, I would say definitely use a champagne style yeast, perhaps. But then again, I mean the craft market in America, they're using beer yeasts and things like that to sort of bring a point of difference.
Yeah, I've always used either a standard wine yeast or a super wine yeast. I haven't tried a beer yeast yet. I've used cider, well, at least what homebrew manufacturers term a cider yeast. I'm not really sure what that even is, to be honest, but I'm going to try one. Experimental Brewing is a series of videos that I have, so it's open-ended. I can just keep experimenting, try various things.
Well, maybe we should try some of your cider soup now.
I think we should.
Yeah. Excellent. And was that not just a link?
That was a link! He's a pro!
Here we are. Come on in.
Let's do it.